Good morning, and thank you, Liz, for that introduction. I'd like to present a brief interview of why and how we've changed BP's restart assurance process. What have we found, and what does the future hold, I guess? Inevitably, of course, I'll only be able to touch on most of the issues that we'll discuss, so very happy to get into detail with any questions in the panel session a little later this morning. Firstly, why did we change our approach at all? I guess going back a few years, like I'm sure most of you in the room today, we recognise that when we're restarting a plant after a major piece of shutdown maintenance, there's an increased risk of some high consequence losses of containment. So we went back, we looked at our standards, and at that time, we were pretty comfortable. We felt the standards covered the right issues and that they were working for us. So it was a matter of continuous improvement. However, in 2011, we had an incident shown in this picture here, a loss of containment on restart. A valve had been left partially open on this differential pressure gauge, and more importantly, the vent line hadn't been capped either. So, of course, we investigated this. That confirmed that the instrument was inside our isolation boundary for the turnarounds, but was not associated with any turnaround work scope at all. Most likely, the valve had been opened to verify the equipment was depressured, but that hadn't been recorded in any of our systems as it should have been, and nor had it been closed as it should have been. Interestingly, as far as we can determine, the vent line has never ever been capped, which speaks to the quality of line walking over a number of years. This was a relatively old asset. So we recognised that our existing standards weren't working for us, and we set out to determine how can we prevent similar occurrences to this in the future? How can we cover risks that are outside the tower work scope as well as inside the tower work scope? And of course, all of that's in service of being able to deliver zero leaks on startup. So what did we find? Primarily, we found that the standards seemed very clear, but when you really tested them, there was ambiguity. They weren't making life easy for the reader to understand what was actually wanted. Statements such as there'll be a full line walk or all work shall be leak tested seem very clear. But then you start asking, well, what is a full line walk? Is that a full line walk of all the work that we've undertaken in the tower? Or perhaps it's a full line walk within the boundary isolation, which is something different again. Or perhaps it's a full line walk of the entire process system. Similarly, for leak testing, is a local leak test acceptable, or should we be testing the entire system? It's probably obvious to most of you, but perhaps worth stating that particularly in a tower, a lot of the breaking of containment for preparation, so our purging, our isolating, our draining of systems, can potentially be quite remote from the work site itself. That's probably particularly so in a turnaround where we'll be making use of boundary isolations, which will be well remote from many of the work sites. The consequence of this ambiguity was, of course, we had variance in application, certainly across platforms, and at time even between shifts. That causes confusion, it leads to disagreements, it can lead to errors, and it also led to repeat work, which is not good either. So in terms of resolving this, I think there were two issues which were really key to success. Some of them have been mentioned, in fact, both of them have been mentioned already this morning. The first of these two issues was absolute clarity of management expectations. You are required to deliver zero leaks on startup, no ambiguity whatsoever. But more importantly, that was backed up by commitment. It wasn't just words. a real genuine commitment to allow us to complete whatever activity was required to deliver on that expectation of zero leaks. And I think that very visible commitment has been absolutely essential to us in creating the foundation to achieve rigorous application offshore. That's only half of the story, though. The other half, as we've mentioned, is about offshore engagement, and it's about getting the right people to write the standards in ways that the offshore operators can understand. So the processes were written by ops personnel preparing for the 2012 turnarounds. They were reviewed by ops personnel on all of our assets, so we can be very sure that they're written in words that people understand. Interestingly, there's been relatively little change of content. I think the issue is one of removing ambiguity, of creating clarity, and then executing that. So I'm absolutely convinced that in clarifying the scope of the restart assurance we wish to undertake, clarifying the extent of that restart assurance, and then driving very hard the quality of execution, we have continued and will continue to achieve a step change in the consistency and rigour of our restart assurance. We have had some changes, though, and I'll talk further on these in a moment. We've introduced a system of independent dispensation. We recognise that you can't possibly in one document write a set of standards that's going to cover every situation on every platform all of the time. But we didn't want to allow individual platforms to start creating their own approach. So any dispensation from our standard will go through the Ops Technical Authority in Aberdeen. And we've also introduced a process of independent audit, again driving consistency. And lastly, of course, a commitment that each time we restart from a tower, we'll take feedback, we'll take learning, and we'll improve our practices. So if I talk briefly, text has got a bit small, about some of the key components. Before that, it's possibly worth noting that we've put in place a structured approach that escalates the requirements depending on the size of the tower. So if you've got a small single issue, perhaps an emergent tower to fix a breakdown, very local activity sets, there's a relatively simple set of controls that focus on that local risk. For a larger, extensive, time-consuming turnaround taking weeks or months, then obviously there is a much more extensive set of requirements which I'll run through just now. So we've clarified our approach to leak testing. We will focus and are focusing on fewer, larger leak tests. The leak tests will cover the entire system wherever we've had any breaking of containment on that system. For all our pneumatic tests, which is a majority, we'll be doing nitrogen leak tests with a helium tracer in them, which of course is pretty searching. Perhaps worth mentioning, over a number of years we've been focusing to reduce our failure rates through leak tests. We're typically seeing, we're down to about a 1% flange failure rate. And the focus to get that even lower is very much on the low-pressure, small-bore, four-bolt flanges, handmade-up type joints. So we're currently down to about a 5% retest requirement on our leak tests. We've also strengthened and clarified our approach to line walking. Worth mentioning, what do I mean by line walking? I don't mean the punch listing exercise, which will be done as part of mechanical completion, very much focusing on the work completion, the quality of the particular task. And I don't mean the valve lineup that will happen as part of our normal restart procedure. By line walking, I mean an exercise to verify the equipment against the P&ID. We've committed that we will do a full line walk of all our process hydrocarbon systems following our major turnarounds. In that line walk, we'll be checking issues such as the caps and blanks are all back in place. We've removed all our low-pressure test equipment, gauges, hoses. Our critical documentation is up to date, so locked valve registers, for instance. Our instrumentation is correctly lined out, hasn't been any changes during the turnaround. We'll also function check our key control valves, blowdown valves, etc. Small bore pipe work, we'll check for integrity, check we've had no damage through the course of the tar. To do that, we are marking up P&IDs before the tar even starts so that we can give the team doing the line walks a pack, which makes it very clear, very easy, with a checklist against that pack. They know what they've got to sign off, and the team will sign off on every P&ID, each team that walks that P&ID. We've seen some great success, actually, from that those line walks. In addition to the objective of achieving zero leaks, we're also seeing that we've had a 100% success record last year in restarting plants the first time. And we've had very, very stable ramp up as well. Now, that clearly gives a safety benefit if we're not having lots of trips and bumps during restarts, but it also gives a production benefit as well. A new requirement has been to introduce a low pressure gross check of systems that we have not worked on in the tar and therefore have not been leak tested. This is very much a final check to guard against an issues where a valve, for whatever reason, might have escaped our systems and been left open, such as the photo I showed earlier. We continue to apply full certification. Essentially, there's little change here. We're using the QEDI certification database. That is standard practice across BP mods and projects, and we're currently starting to apply it within a maintenance and operations world as well. Within TARS, we fully apply that certification process. I'm sure, as per the certification processes that you'll be using, that's got all the issues around punch listing, mechanical completion, system handover, etc. What we are focusing on is making sure that the structure of that certification process is really well organised, so that when we get into the latter stages of the tar, it really helps us manage the completions process through to the endpoint. One of the perhaps most critical new areas that we've put in place is a commitment to an offshore restart assurance audit. An independent audit, so we'll send a team of two people, an experienced auditor, plus an OAM or an ops engineer who's been through a tar on another asset in recent times. By going round about just after mechanical completion, much of the certification will be starting to come in so we can check the quality. We may have completed the first leak tests, we can check the quality of that. The early systems might be going through line walking. So the audit team can really verify the quality of the restart assurance work, check that it's compliance with the standards that we're now setting. That audit has also been a very valuable tool in sharing best practice from asset to asset, of course, by having independent personnel from other assets involved. We've had a restart assurance checklist in place for a number of years. We have clarified that checklist. The checklist is very much managed by the installation manager. It's using his team to make sure that all the different components that contribute to delivering zero leaks on restart are fully completed. What we have now absolutely clarified is sign-off on that document is ultimately by the duty holder. And that is his approval to reintroduce hydrocarbons at the end of the turnaround. So the checklist obviously covers a certification. It covers a wealth of other issues such as management of change. Have we completed our leak testing program? Are our isolations in the status we expect them to be? Line walking, we've mentioned, is completed. Is our control of work in the status we accept it to be? Have all permits been signed up? Are our startup procedures approved for the particular circumstances of the restart from this tar? Have we got sufficient competent technicians in place? And is a plant in the status it needs to be? Has scaffold been removed, fire and gas, ESD systems online, chemicals, utilities in commission, etc.? Lastly, we've committed to use a new piece of equipment, a FLIR camera. This is a very sensitive handheld device, incredibly sensitive, and it'll detect fugitive emissions down to in the order of 1 gram per hour, so in many cases more sensitive than a handheld gas detector. Strictly, of course, that's post-startup. It's only of any use once you've put hydrocarbons back into the system, but it does form a very useful integral part of our restart assurance process. It gives us the opportunity for a very rapid scan of the process modules as we've introduced or reintroduced hydrocarbons to rapidly check for any change in low-level fugitive emissions that we may have had through the course of the tour. So I guess moving on to successes, you know, 2012 was the first year that we've applied this level of rigour, and I'm pleased to say that across a considerable number of TARs, six major TARs on manned sites, a large number of unmanned platforms down in the southern gas fields, total TAR programme in excess of 370 days, we successfully started up without a single loss of containment. That, of course, is just 1 year, though. It's one data point. Now we need to be able to repeat that year on year. Some of the examples that we found, leak testing, we obviously found issues that I'm sure you will be familiar with from leak testing programs. One particular example that surprised me was uncovering a failed joint on a pump that had been factory refurbished and tested, and the leak test offshore confirmed or identified a problem. The restart assurance audit, as I've said, identified a number of issues. A lot of those were slight discrepancies in practice across different of our platforms, but some issues that have been valuable to resolve. We had one site where we discovered a discrepancy between the master P&IDs and our locked valve register, for instance. So we were able to understand, you know, why has that occurred, and we were able to resolve it. On another asset, we uncovered that our witness joint procedure wasn't being fully applied. Where we've got joints that we know we won't be able to leak test, we insist that they're witnessed by a second person. And as a result of that, we remade a number of joints. And lastly, on the line walk, numerous issues, many of them small, a good number of them historic issues rather than from the turnaround itself. On one asset, we found a spec blind out of position. On investigation, we actually found it was a P&ID that was wrong, and the P&ID was updated. And this photo, I don't know if you can see it, on one platform, we found a crack in some seawater pipe work that would have caused a problem had we restarted. As it was, fortunately, we were able to restart with this piece of pipe work isolated. So very quickly to finish, where are we going in the future? 2012 was the first year of use. We have taken the feedback from application in 2012, and the focus has been to clarify what our standards are. So we've made some minor changes to our documentation. We've clarified what should be on the punch listing exercises. We've clarified the makeup of the line walking team, for instance. Going forward into 2013, my objective this year is very much to achieve the same end goal, of course, but to get more efficient about it. As we get practice, we should expect to get more efficient. I think we can probably better use our ops techs. We can get more slick with our certification. We can get more efficient in our management of punch list items. We can optimize our procedure for gross checks, etc. So a number of opportunities to get more efficient and apply the same level of rigour. We're also improving the use of the FLIR camera and working with a vendor to do that. We're looking to make the cameras lighter. We'd like to introduce an EX-approved camera, and we're also improving the training so the guys are getting better value from it. Longer term, the commitment will remain to drive to maximise the benefit of the restart assurance, apply ALART principles, of course, continue to take feedback and learning from each and every TAR. critically to update and improve the process, but also always be asking ourselves, is there anything that we're missing? Is there anything that we're just not seeing? The end measure of that will, of course, be our success. It will be to deliver on our objectives of zero leaks, not just 1 year, but year on year on year. And I thoroughly expect that we'll get there. So thank you for your time. I hope that's been of interest. As I say, it's a very quick cover of a topic that many of you will have some pretty deep understanding of. So very happy to take any questions in the panel session that will follow. Thank you.